Welcome to a new show called Grace Under Pressure. It's on LinkedIn Live and YouTube Live, and it poses questions to thought leaders and doers, those people who have ideas and actions that are helping us come to a greater understanding of ourselves and the opportunities that await us. Grace Under Pressure reveals what's too often dismissed as the soft stuff, the caring, the connecting, the commitment we feel towards one another. Grace for me is generosity we show, respect we give, the compassion we demonstrate. Doing it as a leader, especially now in challenging times, requires that ability to act for others and energize people around you. And I can think of no better guest than my colleague, Marshall Goldsmith 100 Coaches, than Lou Carter, who has spent decades researching this very topic about love in the workplace. So let me tell you a little bit about Lou. No kidding aside, Lou's a trailblazer. He's the president and founder of the Best Practice Institute. He's an executive coach, author of 11 books, widely published. He's also created the Emotional Connectedness Index. And this is germane to us, what it takes to be a most loved workplace. Name a company, Lou's probably consulted for them. Top 500, he's been quoted and profiled in Forbes, CNBC, CEO World Magazine, CIO World Magazine. He's everywhere. He's also a good friend. And Lou is the kind of person, if you need assistance, and Lou is a busy person, he will stop and he will help you. So welcome to Grace Under Pressure, Lou. Happy to have you as a guest.
John, thank you so much for having me.
It's great. You know, Lou, we've talked about this. Executives are under tremendous pressure. We've got three crises going on, economic and twin viruses of racism, social injustice, and of course, the pandemic. So what are you hearing from your clients? What are they telling you? What are their fears?
It's disparate. Many companies that we're working with are going on listening tours. They're collecting a lot of data, a lot of information from employees across the organization. Typically, we work with organization sizes 3,000 all the way up to 100,000 plus. So it's hard to get that kind of sample size for everybody. So listening is critical right now. Collecting data is critical right now, as well as really staying and sticking on to the goals that we require to remain in business and to move forward and become really that next step for the business. We can't let things go.
Right. What kind of fears are you hearing from people in senior positions?
There's a lot of fears that weren't too atypically from the before. They're questioning their job security. They question also going back to work. What is it like to go back to work right now? Will they be wearing a mask? Will others be wearing a mask? We've seen practices being put in place where there's various types of bracelets that people wear. One is you can hug me and you can or shake my hand. The other is stay 6 feet. And the other one is I'm completely socially distant. Don't talk to me. And that kind of choice-based in-person work environment helps when it's required. People still have that enormous fear, though, of going to work. And the majority of people request either a blended experience or completely work at home.
Right. So the fear is important. I'm glad you mentioned that, because I think we're going to end up with a hybrid or a blended workplace. And you have done significant research, and which leads us right into your brand new book. Show us a picture of that, Lou, or raise it up for you. And you've got a pack. I ask you to bring about the In Great Company. And it talks about the five steps to creating a culture of the most loved company. So tell me about that.
So you probably heard other kind of lists or way that companies become most loved. The thing that's very different from our list or our most loved workplace is really the role of salary and compensation. While it's important in the structure, it's not everything. It's about 2 out of 10 of the over 400 executives that we surveyed, as well as the over 2,000 employees worldwide that we studied across the board for EMEA, APAC, and US, found that salary and compensation were only were low on the list in terms of why they wanted to work for their workplace, they loved their workplace, and why they wanted to perform more and better, up to 2 to 3 times more. The factors that were most important were factors really that, John, you talk about a lot, which is respect. And what's different about this is we ask, is friendship important or respect more important? And people said unequivocally, it wasn't about friendship. You don't have to be my friend, but you do need to respect me. And that does come down to some of the original, as we were saying, some civil unrest that had occurred back in the 60s with people just like Jackie Robinson, one of the great, arguably one of the greatest baseball players of all time. And he said very clearly, you don't have to be my friend. You do have to respect me. And right. he was wildly disrespected. The same holds true for corporate America today, John, right? Yeah. We need more grace. We need more respect. And that was the key critical component, is how do we create that culture of respect, that culture that enables us to want to do more and better inside of the company.
What I like about your what you've done, Lou, is you've quantified this through your research. And so, you know, we talk about, you know, kindness and respect in a workplace, and people say, yeah, but they really want it and it makes a difference, correct?
It does. People want it and it does make a difference. And they see that it's a reciprocity. It's a currency of respect. And people say, well, what does it mean, right? What is respect? It's defined in different ways. There is a fundamental way you can define it, however, that is more quantifiable, right? And we do it in this way. We say, in what ways are we collaborating systemically throughout the company? What does collaboration really mean? It means that we have ideas, yet we give it to others to ask for what they appreciate about it the most and what you can do better with it. So co-creation is not just saying we're going to all create something all at once. It says we have ideas, we are the way we are, we behave in certain ways, and we're open to being better, open to becoming more effective. That's my first part.
Yeah, and I think that what's important to that is getting back to, you can't really collaborate truly unless you respect one another. Am I correct?
Absolutely. There's no way it can happen. We can joke with each other. That's fine. We can understand things. You can understand how we work together. However, there's that fundamental respect that must be there. And if needed, we have to define it. We have to say what it is, and we have to actively define it with each other so that we can know our boundaries when it sometimes it's just not very clear.
Right. Okay. So did you have another step in here? Am I missing something? Yeah. So
yeah, the second one, so it's SPARK, S-P-A-R-K. So the second one is P, which is positive vision for the future. And this is really, see it with a CEO like Hubert Joly. Hubert Joly was brought in by Jim Citrin from Spencer Stewart. The reason why Jim chose Hubert Joly is because Hubert had a vision for the future. He said, Best Buy, he said, I'm noticing that everybody here comes in and they treat it basically like a showcase. He says, that's not going to work because they're testing the barcodes or finding out that they want or don't like the products and check the prices and they leave. Right. Says, how do we keep them there? So he said to the board and everybody there, I see a vision for us becoming a knowledge center, a place that we can help our customers so they can stay and keep in community with them. Thus the Geek Squad and the way that we Best Buy really interacts and keeps interaction with customers to help them with their components becoming more partners. He had that vision and he drove it through the company. That kind of positive vision for the future, staying positive about it and ensuring that we can get to that future state, being super clear, is essential.
What role, we're in crisis now, what role does this positivity have? How important is it, Lou?
Positivity is huge. When, you know, John, whenever I talk to you, I feel even more energized and positive because we look at that appreciation. We look at the future forward thinking. We let go of the past, the feedback. People are saying, give me some feedback. Come on, we're going to punch and get, that's not, feedback is old. It's gone. Feed forward is where it's at. Created by our good friend, Marshall Goldsmith, that coined the phrase feed forward. It's about the future. When you give people advice for the future, you stay positive. And you talk about appreciative inquiry. appreciation first. What did I do well? Then what did I, can I do better? It comes from a different perspective and you're less likely to feel horrible, right, John? When you're told something that you could do better, let go of the past of the dream, and go to the future.
You know, I think that's a wonderful concept for now, because we are actually as terrible as things are. This is an opportunity for reinvention. Would you not think? And so let's do things differently. And what you work on and have for your career is culture, and what, everything you've done. And so how do we keep our culture alive? How do we keep that respect going when we're in a hybrid workplace?
So that comes to the third one, really, the alignment of values. Because when you discussed hybrid workplaces, some of our values are, I want to stay home, or I see being at home as productive or even more productive than being at work. And in a study we did of the remote workforce, happy to share it with everybody here, found that the 60% of people in our study wanted to stay working from home. And they all believe they will be more productive. So they self-reported high productivity when they stay home, and they're able to balance it. The remainder were people who actually worked at or in person at back at work. Those people did not know if they would become more productive. So there is a lot of room for hybrid development.
Okay, good. And your fourth step?
Yep. That's so the respect is in the middle. The four steps essential. It's killer outcomes. It's really getting to that part where you achieve and you keep goal orientation. I harken back to the objectives and key results by John Doerr. You probably know the Rice Institute, John Doerr. Objectives and key results, goals, staying true to goals, making sure they're aligned, specifying that we're getting them done no matter what. We're getting through and we're working through our barriers. We're going forward rather than backward and being stuck. We have to get unstuck and move.
And our goals, I would guess, in our times of uncertainty become even more important. But what's the role of flexibility, agility, shall we say?
Yes. And John, you and I did work on this, on resilience. You've written some great work on resilience as well. And learning agility, leadership agility, resilience is critical inside of companies right now, because we have to be able to go through the process, really, of letting go. So this old Sarah model, the sadness, anger, resistance, and acceptance, you have to do that in 30 seconds. So you don't, right? Ready? Let's think of something catastrophic and go through it in 30 seconds. Because really, and it's important to do it with grace, because with respect, because we still need to acknowledge and we need to understand and we need to be able to mitigate risk and to move forward in a way that respects yourself and others. It's essential.
You know, and I'm glad you mentioned the respect for self, because I think initially we go into workplaces when we have a positive sense of self, but we get crossways with a boss or crossways with a colleague, and things don't work out as expected. And so we lose our confidence, and maybe we lose a degree of our self-respect there. So that's so important. And how the cultures that you think succeed, how do they address that?
Cultures that succeed truly are able to have these co-creation sessions and have strong leadership at the top. I believe co-creation, and I've seen this time and again, it's happened since, you know, the 60s in co-creation sessions, and literally people coming together, and happened at GE in the 80s and IBM in the 90s and then Google and Facebook and the high growth companies do co-creation. So there's usually a very strong foundational leader who has a wonderful ethic and is able to share that vision, has the grace and respect for not only the profession, but for others, and a great team around them. And it doesn't have hubristic leadership where they have a low level of competence to complete a task, and yet they're overly confident and think they can do it better than anybody else. Yep. So having that really great leader at the top and co-creating inside of the session so that there's a fundamental respect and trust inside of that group. When it's not there, everyone knows. And it has to be slowly extracted, not the person necessarily, slowly deconstructed and reconstructed so that it's focused on this concept of love, which is most loved workplace. Right. And one that we'll see really not just in this study, but you'll see when people say, I love my workplace, there's a reason for that. It's because people respect each other.
Right. And so when we talk about a most loved workplace, which is a wonderful, terrific concept, and you know, I know your clients like the work that you do because they hire you and they hire you over and over again. But now that what does a workplace mean now? I mean, if we're in working from home or not in the office, how do we define a workplace?
I agree, John. I'm hearing that it's become more undefinable. It's become more of an amoeba effect. We can't follow what this workplace really means, because before there was an amoebic effect to the workplace. We're at Starbucks or we're at some coffee shop or we're doing work on the beach, right? And or at home. Now it's, I have to do it from home under a stay at home order, or I go nowhere, or I have to go hybrid work and home. So the workplace eventually will get to homeostasis. We will balance one day. Now our practice of becoming a most loved workplace has to be even more so data driven, because now our values are coming to the forefront, all of our strong individual values, because we're finally bringing what is home, not being at home and being home here, right, John? Well, we know what that is.
Yes.
Home here in our hearts, our minds, to our work. And it has to do with family. Now you're going really close to home. It has to do with how we work, live, be, know, believe, far greater than it's ever been before.
And what's a leader's responsibility in driving home those values? How does that play in?
Yeah, driving home those values requires that repetition continuously. So there was a study that showed that you had to repeat the same idea over 30 times in a 5-day period before anyone ever knew it. Yeah. People think of 1,000 things per second, and they're milliseconds, and they need to redo their neural bundles. Therefore, you must repeat mantras, positive statements. These things aren't all soft, they're real. And if you look up neuroscience and neural bundling, you'll see what we mean by this. Positive statements, continuous, then living it in the real workplace.
Right. And I think it comes down to creating, and the work that you do is, what we're doing is creating a culture of affirmation. Am I correct?
Absolutely. Affirmation is critical. And in your book, Grace, you talk about the affirmation as well. And in your work, affirmation is critical. So it's not just self-affirmation, it's team affirmation, it's other affirmation, and it's organizational affirmation. So if we see a CEO who walked out onto the floor, or operational, or manufacturer, wherever you may be, healthcare, that CEO has to be the very change that he or she or they want to be inside the company. So if they're not, they're actually at odds, or they're resisting the culture itself. Leaders need to know that they're being watched every single moment when they go into either the floor, customers, anywhere, that under a microscope. And what they say, what they do, how they act, is essential. So if you need to collect, or you need somebody to collect information about perception of you, because otherwise this kind of affirmation for truth becomes distorted.
And I'm glad you talked about this, because leadership, so much of what we call authenticity is actually perception. You know, if we think about if we think about a brand, who owns it? It's your customer. So who owns a leader's brand? Well, it's the followers. And so what you said about being on stage all the time and being cognizant is so critical. What does that mean on our virtual stage now?
Yeah, our virtual stage is the one that you and I are standing on right now, John. we're here and there's people on LinkedIn are watching us, which is essential, right? We need people to follow, to listen. We now have to think about different ways to gather their attention with massive amounts of noise in their way. We need to knock out noise so that people can listen, want to listen, have a reason to listen. We have to adjust and resonate with people, all these things. And I think resonance is really critical now that we're on that stage, we're on the virtual stage, and keying into what people are thinking, massive amounts of people are thinking and feeling.
Right. That's great. Was there one more step that did you wanted to add, or have we covered your section? I wanted
The last one was at the center of the whole model. It was the R, which is the respect and the reciprocal relationship. And that was the critical part as well in the steps. And in the book, you had mentioned you wanted me to show you this. If you go to page 205, and here I actually put the whole research methodology, all the questions, the whole assessment in there. I give it away. So we always learn that people say, well, what are you doing? I gave it away. Some people don't do that. In most of workplace, you need it for your entire company. So, you know, it's something to look at. And so that, yeah, absolutely.
Correct. Well, I'm glad you twinned respect with reciprocity, because that's really how cultures are nurtured. Yes, it's one thing to respect, but you have to put that respect into action. And that's where reciprocity comes in. And how do leaders set the example in that regard, Lou?
Yeah. So how do you set the example for respect? And so respect is, it's first listening. So there's two sides to it, inquiry and advocacy. So inquiry really is the active questioning in a way that's respectful. What are you doing well? You think of a breach of inquiry. Tell me more about this. Giving other people airtime. Airtime is a form of respect. You know, many leaders who talk ad nauseum and teaching people, right? They're teaching constantly. Right. Better, we shift from teacher and to facilitator, leader as facilitator. So that's the first, inquiry is essential. Advocacy is being an advocate for the change itself, the new vision, the goals that are necessary for the company, what you want to and need to accomplish to be successful inside the company. So balancing those two, inquiry with advocacy, is essential to creating that culture from a leader level.
Now, I have a question, and it might even sound like your freshman level anthropology 101, but in our workplace, think about this and think of our virtual in our workplace. What does it mean to be human?
Wow, John, this is a big one. Wow.
That's why I asked you, Lou.
Yeah, it's anthropological. We could go through the primates and phylum. I think there's two types of ways that we look at humans, and many of you have heard this probably before, human beings and human doings, right? So I think there's both of them, right? So we are, we be and we believe and we become. So we are who we are, and we can become something different every single moment. We can let go of whoever we were, the Lou of the 3 seconds ago, the John of the 3 seconds ago, and become the Lou or the John of the now, or even 10 seconds from now. Redefine it, mold it in different ways. And then there's the human doing, the Lou, the John doing, right? We do. We have to do in order to be as well. So there's the goal setting, the task delivery, the specifications. You got to do it. You got to work for it if you want it, right? We all know that. John and I both know how hard it is and how much challenge it is to work and to do. Because people think there's overnight successes. Guess what the secret is? There isn't anything as an overnight success. All of a sudden, they became an overnight success. Nope. Do you know what they did for 10 years to get there? Oh, now you find out what that means. Exactly. So human doing is just as important.
Great. As we conclude, I like to ask every guest, what's an example of grace in your life or grace that you want to talk about?
Yeah. Great grace in my life is family. It's absolutely family. It comes right to mind when I hear it. They're my rock. They're everything to me. When I go back home, the way that I can protect and nurture and feel like there's a higher purpose. It all comes back to that. Grace, you speak of grace under pressure. When I go back to, when I have grace under pressure, I think back to family. I think back to my family at home and think about what comes out in me, that protective spirit, that protection that I have. I think grace comes out of protection. That beauty that you're saying, I now can completely have a sense of my emotional empathy, my regulation, because I know what I'm protecting.
Thank you. Lou, you've been an absolute terrific guest. I appreciate it. This has been another episode of Grace Under Pressure, where we invite thinkers and doers like Lou Carter, president or CEO of Best Practice Institute, a good man, a good friend, a good colleague. That's it for now. And till next time, thank you for watching.
Thank you, John.